I'm messing around with AI these days, not with nonsense generative art and videos. In fact, AI can create way more useful stuff, at least that's what I have heard from others, so I want to give my Gemini 3 a challenge to see if it can handle a complex simulation task that I wanted to make in the past but could not. Now, the thing I am trying to create is a web-based planetary system simulator. Starting with the star, which I want to restrict the generation range to main sequence stars. Main sequence stars represent the stable age of stellar evolution and are the most common type of star in the universe. Our sun is currently in this phase. There are also subgiants, red giants, supergiants, and LBVs, of course, but these are much more complicated, and I'm sure that no planet wants to stay with a supergiant star. So, firstly, I'm telling Gemini 3 to create a web page that simulates a random main sequence star. I want to use the real mass distribution to the generation logic. If don't know, there is something called the initial mass function. The initial mass function is essentially the demographic census of stellar birth, describing the statistical distribution of masses for a population of newly formed stars. For every rare, blazing blue giant that will explode as a supernova, within a few million years, the universe spawns thousands of dim, low-mass red dwarfs that will quietly burn for trillions. Then, I gave the simplified function to Gemini 3, and I require it to generate and visualize the mass, radius, surface temperature, luminosity, and metallicity as well. The metallicity of a star refers to the abundance of elements heavier than hydrogen and helium within its composition. Yep, astronomers see everything heavier than helium as metal. This affects the properties of a star and even influences the evolution path. Okay, and here it goes. This is what it delivers, and it's actually looking very decent. It even shows the spectral type of the star for me. I didn't ask for it. But I don't like the fonts, so I'm telling it to switch to a more clear and bold font first. Now better, a lot more pleasing, but I'm not that easy to be satisfied. Now I need it to create an HR diagram for me, showing the position of the star based on its temperature and luminosity. And it works! So far, it looks pretty darn good. There is the HR diagram, the star icon also has its unique color based on temperature, which I like this detail, although the diagram as a whole still looks a bit unpolished, but I can tweak that in a second. Alright, now it is a main sequence star simulator. Of course, I haven't tested whether these values it spewed out are really scientifically legit or nonsense, but you can see this random one, it looks quite realistic, at least from the first glance. Let's see if we can generate a big one. Oh, there it is! A blue giant with 6.2 times the mass of the sun and 821 solar luminosity. That's pretty cool. By the way, there is a star in the Pleiades cluster called Alcyon, which is also about 6 times the solar mass, but it's 1750 times brighter than sun, because it has evolved for some time and becomes brighter than when it's just formed. Okay, back to my project. With the star being placed, of course we should add some planets to accompany the star. Now this part is a bit even more complicated. To generate a realistic planetary system, there are 3 things should be determined. First is the mass. The planets are essentially formed from the remnants of a star-forming molecular cloud. So higher mass stars generally have more massive disks, as massive stars form from more massive clouds of gas and dust, leading to more massive initial disks. A potential planet-to-star mass ratio of about 0.1 to 0.3% is often conducted in relevant research, so I'm giving this information to AI. Second is the type of planets. Firstly, planets won't just spawn here and there. In the inner region, the radiation level is relatively high. This would keep light materials like hydrogen and helium away, only leaving the rocks and iron. That's why we are seeing rocky planets in the inner solar system, while gas giants and ice giants are in the outer solar system. However, planets can migrate. They can emerge in one region and move to another. That's why we can see some crazy hot Jupiters orbiting very close around its star. Or maybe they just fell in love with their star. Also, studies have shown that planets of all sizes have an increased occurrence rate around metal-rich stars compared to metal-poor stars. For instance, our sun has decent metallicity, and it has 8 or even 9 planets hugging around. But the Methuselah star, which was likely formed in the early Milky Way galaxy, is a metal-poor star. And it has no planet, as we know, even having 75% the mass of our sun. This is probably because the metallicity of protoplanetary disks affects how quickly planetary cores can form and whether they accrete a gaseous envelope before the gas dissipates. So I should also hint about this piece of information. Also, planets can't be too close, otherwise they cause gravitational instability and ruin the whole system. I also want every planet to be unique on their own, so I came up with a component scale, giving the ratio of iron, silicate, and light materials, and determine their type based on the ratios. For instance, a rocky planet might have 75% of silicate and 25% of iron, while a gas giant might contain 90% of hydrogen and some iron and silicate in its core. All right, I think that sets up the general framework, so I'm just giving a whole bunch of rules to Gemini 3.0, and hopefully it would work out instead of blowing this up. And that's very cool. That is actually exceeding my expectation. And it even calculated the frost line for me. Let's see, gas giant, the composition, 2% of iron, 3% of silicate, 10% of water, and 85% of hydrogen. The composition looks very realistic too. See another system, terrestrial, 30% of iron, 65% of silicate. Cool. That frost line reminds me I forgot adding the temperature system. Oh, there is still a small issue. The planets are all too massive. I should adjust the mass function curve. All right, looks like Google's really doing a good job, especially their stock price.
So now I'm nudging closer to a complete project. The next thing is the temperature system. The effective temperature can be calculated with the stellar radiation, and then giving some terrestrial planets an atmosphere. The atmosphere can generate greenhouse effect. Our Earth, for instance, the effective temperature is just minus 18 degrees Celsius. But with a thick atmosphere, the planet is warmer by more than 30 degrees. In reality, the greenhouse effect of a planet is influenced by many factors. One of the most important factors is the composition of the atmosphere. Molecules such as water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and ozone absorb infrared radiation and re-emit it, trapping heat near the surface. The total mass of the atmosphere also matters. A thicker atmosphere generally enhances greenhouse warming because it increases the amount of infrared absorbing material and raises the surface pressure, which broadens absorption lines and strengthens the effect. The albedo of a planet, which is how much light its surface and clouds reflect, also affects how much energy it absorbs. A high albedo surface, like ice or thick reflective clouds, reduces heating, while dark oceans or land absorb more energy and increase warming. Even the star's spectral type matters. Cooler stars emit more infrared radiation, which greenhouse gases absorb efficiently. But again, sticking these things inside would be too complicated, so I'm going to oversimplify some physics. Firstly, give the planet an atmospheric pressure value, and just allow the greenhouse effect intensity to be positively correlated with atmospheric pressure using a logarithmic function. Then refine the visualization. I want to show a translucent green ring around the star to represent the habitable zone and replace the frost line. Then, I don't know why the AI used a logarithmic scale to present the orbit, so I'm telling AI to use the linear scale and add a zooming feature. And again, there's a bunch of instructions here, and the rest is handed by AI. So far, I haven't tweaked any of the code by myself, just AI building the whole script.
And now we can see the results. Honestly, it's not that perfect on some design details, but how can I blame that? I can't even write the code myself. The star view is redundant right now, and just keep the orbit map. And atmospheric pressure, okay. Temperature, okay, all looking good. The temperature has a color. Seems like putting 0 to 100 degrees Celsius in the region of green, which makes sense. And there is a habitable zone. Okay, so far, so good. I should make the planet radius value visible too.
The next step is to polish the features. Firstly, remove the star view. Secondly, the 3D map right now is already good, but maybe I can tweak it better. Third, maybe I should add a switch button to fit another visualization panel that shows the planet one by one closely, in the order of distance, and just let AI do it step by step. Okay, now the generator looks better and better. We have a size scale mode. Oh, it added labels for me, thanks. And the orbit map also looks smoother right now, not the former pixelized style. And it also added radius figures for me. Now I'm refining the generator further. For now, the planets all look like the same, without textures. So I'm giving the AI a challenge to see if it can also generate textures for the planets and make sure the generator is not clunky. See if it can handle this. And it just listed a series of things that it's trying to deliver. Then it did try to make some effort. Though it didn't look great, at least it could understand my requests, which was already quite an accomplishment. Maybe I can nudge it further. Since it previously just threw me some fuzzy color patches, this time I need to go hardcore. Take gas giants, for instance. Their defining feature is atmospheric stripes caused by rapid rotation. So I instructed the AI, when generating these planets, stretch the noise patterns to form distinct horizontal cloud bands, ideally with a few randomly placed storm eyes like the Great Red Spot. For Earth-like planets, the logic is entirely different. Just use fractal Brownian motion to generate irregular continental plates.
Now a bit better, though still not very delicate. But again, maybe I can reach a beautiful state if I instruct the AI further. So as you can see, in just less than 20 minutes, together with AI, use thousands of lines of code and a stack of mathematical formulas to build a miniature slice of the universe within the browser's sandbox. Though these stars and planets exist only in memory, vanishing with a simple refresh, the sensation of creating a world from nothing is truly wondrous. This is what I wanted to share. Instead of using AI to generate boring images, try making it your co-pilot for exploring complex systems. Anyway, I'll post a link to this page in the description section. If you'd like to venture into the cosmos and see if you can generate your own second Earth, feel free to give it a try. And if you want something different from that, just make your own. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.